Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021, and a warm welcome to Graeme Simpson, MSP, who's joining the committee this morning. The first agenda item this morning is a decision to take item number 5 in private. The committee is also being asked to consider the evidence that we hear in future meetings in private. Are members of the committee agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We're agreed to take agenda item number 5 and all future consideration of evidence in private. We shall now move to agenda item number 2. The committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the Ministerial Statement of COVID-19, subordinate legislation and the other matters noted in the agenda. I welcome to the meeting our witnesses from the Scottish Government: John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery; Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director; Elizabeth Sadler, Deputy Director of COVID Ready Society; and Graham Fisher, Deputy Director of the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Thank you for attending this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including the COVID update to Parliament from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on Tuesday and the COVID recovery strategy and other issues. As set out in the update to Parliament, we continue to work closely with health boards as they deal with pressures in the run-up to winter. We announced an additional package of winter support backed by a further £10 million for a range of measures to support A&E systems and to ensure that patients have access to the correct care as quickly as possible. We've implemented an approach intended to maintain the pace of the vaccination programme as we enter the flu season by maximising the availability of scheduled appointments and ensuring the efficient vaccination of people against both COVID-19 and seasonal flu. Vaccination remains one of our most effective public health interventions against the pandemic. We also announced changes to the rules around international travel, including the removal of the final 7 countries from the international travel red list. Turning now to the 26th Conference of the Parties, the Scottish Government has been working closely with the United Kingdom Government and partners in Scotland, including Glasgow City Council, Transport Scotland, NHS Scotland and Police Scotland, to deliver the COP26 summit successfully and safely. A comprehensive package of mitigation measures is in place, aimed at protecting the welfare of everyone involved and the wider community. In addition to an offer of vaccination to delegates, measures include a robust daily testing regime, contact tracing, hygiene measures that include distancing and face coverings and ventilation. In relation to the regulations we will shortly be discussing, the COVID certification scheme continues to bed in well. Last weekend was the second weekend since enforcement began on the 18th of October. The COVID status app has played a part in the success of this scheme. I would update the committee that the original contract cost of £600,000 for the development of an international travel app awarded to Net Company was formally extended in October by up to an additional £600,000 to reflect the expansion of the original proposal to include new technical development work to support the domestic status of the app. On the statutory instruments before the committee in relation to the first, the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland regulations had been in place since the 28th of August 2020. Those regulations make provision for local authority enforcement powers in respect of businesses, premises, events and access to public outdoor places. The original regulations were due to expire on the 30th of September 2021 and the current regulations extend the original regulations to the 25th of March 2022. This ensures that should local authorities require to take local enforcement action in relation to coronavirus regarding businesses, premises, events and public outdoor places, they will have appropriate powers available to do so. On the second instrument, the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2021, which provides for the COVID certification scheme, the Government recognises the concerns expressed at the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that regulations under the made affirmative procedure can come into force prior to any formal scrutiny by the Parliament and about the procedure applying to these regulations. Our decision to use this procedure for the certification regulations partly reflected considerations around implementation of the vaccine certification arrangement, including the need for businesses and the general public to familiarise themselves with finalised legal requirements underpinning the scheme sufficiently in advance to enable those affected by the scheme rules to take the necessary steps to prepare. I discussed some of that with the committee on the 30th of September. More widely, the Minister for Parliamentary Business set out the considerations we took into account in using the made affirmative procedure. Case numbers remain high, and it is for this reason that urgent action was needed in introducing this important baseline measure of certification, given these factors and the need to take action without delay to address the harms posed by the virus. Under the difficult circumstances we still face, I would ask the committee to recommend approval of the regulations and offer my assurance that this measure will continue to be under review and will only remain in place for as long as is necessary. I'm very happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. If I turn to questions, and if I may ask a few questions. Thank you for your response to our letter on the vaccine passport regulations. In the letter, you state that it is not possible to establish the individual impact of the scheme on changes in transmission of the virus. Given that reducing transmission is one of the aims of the scheme, could you please clarify how you are monitoring the impact of the scheme on reducing transmission?
The point that I was trying to make in my response to the committee convener is that it is impossible to segment the headline data that we have access to about the prevalence of the virus and ascribe levels of prevalence of the virus to particular factors. The flip side of that is that it is impossible to ascribe to a particular mitigation measure an avoidance of a situation which has prevailed. So the point that ministers look at is we look at the overall prevalence of the virus, we look at the pressures on the National Health Service, and we make a judgment based on that headline data as to whether it is proportionate and appropriate for mitigation measures to remain in force. Now, that is the three-weekly assessment that ministers undertake. We have to complete that again for the 16th of November, which will be the next three-weekly point at which we consider these issues. And we do that looking at all of the available evidence that we have to hand, and to make a judgment about the extent to which the virus continues to present a significant threat to the wider population and crucially to the sustainability of National Health Services.
Thank you. Just for transparency to members, the committee requested in its recent letter that certain information would be provided to Parliament alongside the three-week review, and that this information to be laid in spice. Some of the information we requested goes beyond the information provided in the weekly State of Epidemic Report. Your letter noted that only some of the information requested is held by the Scottish Government. Notwithstanding this, it appears that the available information requested was not laid on spice, in spice, and the most recent review point on the 26th of October. Will the Scottish Government commit to providing the information requested by the committee at the next review point and all the subsequent review points?
I'll certainly look at that point, Convener. You know, the Government does publish, as I've said to the committee on a number of occasions, a vast amount of information about the prevalence of the virus and the associated data sets that we have in relation to the management of the challenges that we face. If there is more information, obviously the committee wrote to me about a range of requests. We will endeavour to provide as much information as we possibly can do. The State of the Epidemic Report already contains a huge amount of information already, but if there is more information that members believe it would be helpful to be available, then we'll certainly consider that.
Thank you. As I mentioned last week, the COVID-19 Recovery Committee is trialling an online public platform to allow members of the public to ask questions. Helen Goss has got in touch this week, and she has said, there is a distinct lack of protections for children in education settings. Schools are having to rely on natural ventilation without supplemental ventilation technologies, which will pose a problem going into winter. Latest data from the CLOCK study suggests up to 1 in 7 infected children will develop long COVID. Why isn't the Scottish Government prepared to protect the younger age groups? And if I could just personally add on top of that, do we have any evidence or or data on children developing long COVID?
On the point about data about children and long COVID, I will take that point away and advise the committee as to whether there is any data that can be shared in that respect. And obviously there will be issues around data protection that we'll have to consider in that respect, but I'll look at that and write to the committee on that point. In relation to ventilation, I recognise the significance of this point. It's an issue that I wrestled with extensively when I was the Education Secretary, and my successor has been working with the Education Recovery Group to ensure that there is an appropriate approach to the delivery of ventilation interventions by local authorities in schools around the country. The Education Secretary has written to the Education Committee with an update on the extent of the measures taken to improve ventilation in schools, and also about the inspection regime that has been put in place. We've required local authorities to undertake extensive assessments of ventilation interventions, and that work has been reported on to committee. So the importance, a lot of that emphasis has focused on two things. One has been about ensuring that we have all of the necessary and appropriate data to about the assessments that have been made. And secondly, that there can be changes made to the school estate to enable appropriate ventilation arrangements to be put in place. And the government, of course, has funded the approaches that have been taken by local authorities. I think we have to look at a whole range of different measures. You know, the member of the public who raised the question is concerned about the well-being of children in schools. That is a concern that's shared by ministers. Hence the decision that ministers took, which has not been universally supported, to maintain the use of face coverings in certain circumstances by pupils, has been an important protection to be maintained to try to suppress the spread of the virus within the school estate, and ventilation is another aspect of the baseline measures that we can all take to try to ensure that we tackle the situation.
Thank you. Can I move to Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. Can I go back to the question of the vaccine certification scheme that the Convener touched on in her first question? At last week's one of the purposes of the scheme set out by the Scottish Government is to encourage an increase in uptake of vaccinations. But at last week's meeting of this committee, Mr Mason asked Professor Leach if there was evidence that that had been successful. And Mr Leach gave a very straightforward and honest response, which we would expect, of course. And he said, "I simply do not know." And indeed, Cabinet Secretary, you've confirmed this morning that it's not possible to disaggregate from the general data whether this scheme is actually delivering on the objectives set out. So we don't know if there are positive outcomes from this scheme. What we do know is that there are negative outcomes from this scheme. So the BBC are reporting this morning that more than 42,000 people have reported errors in their vaccination records, and this is causing difficulties for them who want to access vaccine certification. We also know from the nighttime industries that they're seeing a major drop-off in terms of the business coming to their premises, up to 40% of a drop-off having a major negative economic impact. So this policy is turning into something of a disaster, is it not?
No, it is not, in no shape or form. And Mr Fraser is completely wrong to characterise the scheme as just being about boosting vaccination levels. That is one of the purposes. And if I provide Mr Fraser with some data, as of the 1st of September, 53% of the 18 to 29 population group, which I think we would all accept is probably the most important group in relation to the Nighttime Industries Association, 53% of that group had both doses of the vaccine. 1st of October, shortly thereafter, the government announced we were going to embark on this approach. Shortly thereafter, on the 1st of October, that figure had risen from 53% to 64%. On the 1st of November, that figure had reached 68%. So there is an increase, a sizeable increase, in the level of vaccination. The second point I would make is that the scheme also has, as part of its objectives, the importance of reducing the risk of transmission, of reducing the risk of serious illness and death, of allowing high-risk settings to continue to operate as an alternative to closure and to increase vaccine uptake. Those are the four bullet points that the scheme is, that surround the scheme. So on each of these measures, reducing the risk of transmission, it is a priority of the government to try to suppress the risk of transmission. To reduce the risk of serious illness and death, that's part of the objectives of the scheme. To allow high-risk settings to continue to operate, again, as an alternative to closure, is being sustained by this scheme, and the increased vaccine uptake is part of the evidence I've just put on the record. Now, what I can't do, as I said to the convener, I can't compartmentalise it, I can't ascribe it all, but it's part of the mix that we have in place. So I think the scheme is delivering a positive benefit to the suppression of the virus. Now, in relation to errors in vaccine certification, I've accepted all along that when you're administering something of the order of 8-9 million doses of the vaccine, you're bound to have errors, bound to have. And even on the data that the BBC is talking about this morning, that's a very small proportion of the amount of vaccination that is being undertaken. So I think the vaccine certification scheme is, in Scotland, as it is in many other countries, contributing to the basket of measures that are necessary to deal with a pandemic that continues to pose a serious threat to the well-being of the population.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You've given us your opinion that you believe it is having a positive impact. You've not given us any evidence that that is the case. In fact, you say in your letter to us as a committee of the 28th of October, it is not possible to establish the individual impact of this scheme on changes in transmission of the virus. And as I said earlier, Professor Leach told this committee last week he did not know whether it was encouraging the uptake. So you've expressed your opinion to the committee, but you've not given us any evidence. Can I ask you something else about your letter of the 28th of October? We asked specifically in that letter if you could give us any information on the number of people who've reported difficulties in accessing the COVID status app, their QR code or paper copies, and you say data is not available. We then asked if you could tell us the number of people who had reported inaccuracies with the information contained in their vaccination record, and you said data is not currently available. And yet the BBC have been able to obtain, through Freedom of Information, that 42,000 people have complained about inaccuracies. So why have the BBC been able to obtain this information when you were not able to give it to this committee?
That's an issue that's causing me some degree of concern this morning, and I intend to investigate that after the committee. I've obviously just become aware of that information that the BBC have published this morning. The letter that I've sent to the committee is based on the advice I take at a given moment. I'm the author of the letter, so I take responsibility for its contents. But I'm concerned about the fact that I'm not concerned about the second last part of Annex A of my letter to the committee, where I say that the number of people who've reported difficulties accessing the COVID status app, I don't think that's in any way contradicted by the data that the BBC have this morning. The final part, however, the number of people who have reported inaccuracies with the information contained in their vaccination record, I am concerned by the detail that says that I have said to the committee that data is not currently available, and I am exploring that point as we speak.
Thank you.
I would be if I was not here.
Yeah.
It's being inquired about on my behalf.
Indeed. Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I go back and ask again about the issue of economic impact? Because we've heard from the Nighttime Industries Association and the Scottish Hospitality Group about a major decline in business at many of their premises since the vaccine passport was introduced. Does the Scottish Government recognise that concern, and if so, what are you doing to try and address it?
I think that
Yeah, part of the point here, Mr. Fraser has concentrated on a number of points of definitive evidence, and I've been absolutely candid with the committee in all my correspondence and in my oral evidence to the committee that we cannot ascribe a direct relationship between one particular measure and one particular outcome. I think that would be misleading to try to do so. There are a basket of measures and interventions that we have to take to suppress the virus and to achieve our other objectives about increasing vaccination. Now, one of the issues that we will have to wrestle with is that the principal issue we've got to wrestle with is that the virus remains a very significant threat to the health and well-being of the population. So we have got to take, and my judgment, government's judgment, I think it's Parliament's judgment as a whole, we've got to take measures to tackle that situation and the seriousness of the impact that could have on the population. Now, when we take particular measures, we are weighing up in all those judgments what is the proportionate action to take. And where we've got rising cases, which we have had, we are now sitting with cases which are, I would say, apart from yesterday's data, stable but very high. Yesterday's data was very high and of great concern, but you shouldn't look at one particular day's data, but yesterday's data was of deep concern to ministers. We have cases that are at too high a level, so we are trying to take measures which are proportionate with our objectives of enabling as much of the economy and our society to recover from COVID, but also at the same time to suppress the virus. Now that's a fine judgment that's got to be arrived at as to what measures to take. Now we know that the nighttime economy is an area of higher risk. We know that from the experience of the pandemic. So we're trying to take measures which enable, consistent with the strategic objective I've just set out, of enabling the nighttime economy to continue, but to do so in as safe a fashion as we possibly can do, which is the justification for the scheme. Now, obviously, there may well be impact on nighttime industries as a consequence, but there could be an even greater impact of closure. And that's what we're trying to avoid by the measures that we're taking. So it's about weighing up what is what can we enable to happen which does not jeopardise our ability to suppress the virus and enable sectors to be able to thrive.
One more question, if I may, Convener. We've heard in evidence, we've heard it as well from our advisors this morning, every other country in Europe that has brought in a vaccine passport scheme allows us an alternative, a negative COVID test. And that gets around some of the concerns that people have expressed around the vaccine passport scheme, in particular the impact on human rights and around civil liberties. Previously, the Health Secretary came to the committee and said that alternative was still under consideration by the Scottish Government. Is that still the case, and is this still being considered as part of the mix? Because I believe it would remove many of the concerns there are about the compulsory vaccination passport scheme.
That option is still under active consideration by ministers.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, Brian Mitchell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to the panel. If I could follow on from some of the points that Murdo Fraser made, I think, as you said, Cabinet Secretary, there are sort of four bullet points, if you like, for the reasons for the implementation of a vaccine passport scheme. One of them being improving vaccine uptake. In my view, by improving vaccine uptake, you actually improve the other three bullet points. You're likely to reduce transmission. You're likely to reduce, the effects of illness and death and pressure on the NHS, which will hopefully help to keep places open. My concern this morning, when we heard one of the phrases that was said this morning by the our advisors, was evaluating blind. And given that we were looking for the most effective way of deployment of resource, again, how do we assess you know, we have to be able to somehow assess the impact of a vaccine passport on that uptake, because we've always tried to say, or we've always said, that we follow the science. You know, there is a suite of measures that the government are taking, but it can't be just surely throwing as much as we can at it and hoping we have an outcome.
I think I wouldn't characterise it in that fashion. I think what we're trying to do is to take a set of very carefully targeted interventions to try to secure our objectives. You know, our strategic intent, which was revised in the summer, is to suppress the virus to a level consistent with alleviating its harms while we recover and rebuild for a better future. Now, that is very different to our previous strategic intent, which was essentially about maximum virus suppression. We're essentially trying to manage the impact of the virus through tools such as vaccination. So I agree with Mr. Whittle's point that vaccine uptake is a significant factor on making venues and circumstances as safe as possible, because it reduces the risk of transmission and provides greater protection for anybody who happens to contract the virus if they are double vaccinated. So we are essentially trying to take what we can, and by law we are required to do this, proportionate measures that enable us to achieve that strategic intent that I've put on the record again. And I think the point that I made no attempt to make this any more precisely than I have made it several times already this morning and on previous occasions, I cannot ascribe a direct relationship between one intervention and the strategic intent. But every 3 weeks we've got to look at the strategic intent and the prevalence of the virus and say, are the measures that we have in place currently providing us with, well, are they appropriate and suitable and proportionate in relation to those steps? And the government believes that to be the case, but obviously we are now going through the process of preparing for the next three-weekly review on the 16th of November, and we have to satisfy ourselves on all of those issues at that moment and report to Parliament accordingly.
And what I'm hearing here in your reply there, and thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary, what I'm hearing here is, in a three-week review, you are unable to ascribe the impact of any of the measures specifically on vaccine uptake, and given that vaccine uptake is, I think, one of the most incredibly important things in terms of tackling the virus here, I think the deployment of resource into vaccine passport and the problems, you know, around the vaccine passport, be that practical or be that in human rights, I just feel it's really important that you are able to persuade the population that this is the right way to go, and I'm not hearing that, Cabinet Secretary.
I would contend, Convener, that the data I put on the record in response to Mr. Fraser's question a moment ago, that as of the 1st of September, that's before the vaccine certification scheme was put in place, 53% of 18 to 29-year-olds had two doses of the vaccine. By the 1st of November, that figure had risen by 15% to 68%. Now, as a proportion of 53%, that's a pretty substantial increase. It's of the order of, it's close to a third. So, you know, that's a really sizeable increase that's taken place. So, I think the scheme supports the objectives the government has taken forward. We will continue to review that, because we have to be satisfied it is a proportionate action. And I confirm to the committee the government will be doing exactly that.
I want to move on, but my issue with that is from a science perspective, you don't know how much of an increase in the vaccination uptake would have been without a vaccine passport. I think that's an issue. But I think, given that the specific groups are less well vaccinated, how are those demographics being targeted? I'm thinking particularly around, you know, I think we know the African population are less vaccinated. So how are we targeting those particular demographics?
We've been using a number of different means and communication, some of it through public information and the campaigns to encourage vaccinations. We've also been working very closely with what I would call trusted voices within these communities. So we've been working with a number of the representative organisations within the BME community. We've been working with different religious figures and faith representatives who have been able to articulate the message to a population that may be sceptical about some aspects of vaccination. So that combination of the wider government messaging on the importance of vaccination coupled to the specific input of trusted voices within those communities, we judge to be the most effective way of taking forward the steps that are necessary.
If I could, one of the other main groups of people that we need to tackle are those who are vaccine hesitant. And what I would ask is, how are we addressing the needs of those? Because we know that if pushing harder is likely to result in a more entrenched view. So what is the Scottish Government doing to speak to this group, as I say, given that vaccine passports does not persuade this particular group to get vaccinated?
I'll say a few words and I'll bring in Professor Leach in a second, because I think the wider messaging that the government takes forward about the risks that are faced by the population from being unvaccinated and the prevalence and significance and seriousness of the impact of the virus on people who are not vaccinated is some of the hard and difficult but necessary information that needs to be shared with members of the public, because if people are unvaccinated, they stand greater risk of contracting the virus and of having a more... Forgive me, I better say that again. They run the risk of having a more serious condition as a consequence of contracting the virus if they are unvaccinated. And it's important for that reason and for many others that we share that clinical information with members of the public, and that's what obviously the communication that the Chief Medical Officer, the National Clinical Director and others are involved in supporting the government to do. Professor Lynch.
Yeah, well, I've invested quite a lot of personal time in talking to those groups that you described. I've discovered groups of called African mums. I've discovered the Polish community, who are the very vaccine sceptical generally. Poland and Japan are the two most vaccine sceptical countries in the world, and we have a very large Polish community. We don't have a huge African diaspora in Scotland, but we've reached out to them with trusted voices. I've done quite a lot of that personally. The trick is for me not to do the persuasion. They're not going to listen to the 53-year-old white guy, but I can persuade trusted leaders, give them the data, give them the information, then they can take it to the communities. We've done a lot of that, and the numbers have gone up, evidenced by the fact that pretty much every over 50-year-old in the country is now vaccinated, pretty much. Every over 60-year-old, for sure. We continue to do that with communication through faith groups, through community groups, through every other group. I wonder if I could say a word or two on COVID certification, since everybody's asked it. COVID certification is now a globally accepted mainstream way of managing the pandemic. Countries all over the world. Now, what our ministers choose to put in COVID certification is a matter for them, but in general, COVID certification is accepted as something that is useful at this stage in the pandemic going forward. Airlines have done it. Party conferences have done it. Countries have done it. Independent businesses, cinema owners have done it. And I hear nighttime industry over the weekend saying we turned away 10 to 20% of people. That sounds to me like COVID certification working. That's exactly what it's meant to do. I was at Murrayfield on Saturday. My vaccine certification was checked as I entered. That crowd was safer because of vaccine certification. No, absolutely no question. It was safer to be at Murrayfield or a full Celtic Park at the weekend because they were vaccine certified. So I think it works. I think the Deputy First Minister is right, though. that I can't draw you a straight line from vaccine certification to this data. That's impossible. I can't draw it from hand washing either, and yet the evidence for hand washing is overwhelming. So inside that basket of measures, COVID certification globally has become one of the ways to manage, in a vaccine world, how to get out of this pandemic.
Thank you. Just for the record, I'm not necessarily against vaccine passports. I want to put that on the record. But what I need to understand is that the implementation of and the way we implement that is the best use of resource in tackling this. That's what I'm on this. Can I ask, back to the addressing the needs of the sort of vaccine hesitance? I think the problem here is, you know, what work's been done to ensure that these people are not being excluded from everyday activities because of their concerns around vaccine passports. I think like, we're trying not to create this sort of two-tier system.
Well, the only circumstances in which vaccine certificates are required for entry are, you know, on a rather limited basis: late night premises with music, serving alcohol, etc. Indoor events unseated with 500 or more people, outdoor events unseated with 4,000 or more people, any event with more than 10,000 people. So, you know, if people want to go to a mass event such as a Scotland rugby match or a large football match, then vaccine certification will be required. And that's because we think that is an effective way of trying to suppress the virus and to improve vaccine uptake. If what we have got to do, and I accept this obligation on government, is to make sure that we provide the highest quality information about the rationale why it is in an individual's best interest to be vaccinated. And I think our clinical colleagues support us and support this argument extremely well in giving dispassionate clinical information to members of the public to aid them in that judgment. And I understand that people will have hesitancy in some circumstances, but all that we can do is provide the best clinical advice, which many of us have followed and which we would encourage other citizens to follow too.
A very quick last question, if I may. It can be, where has the Scottish Government considered what the criteria will be for withdrawing the passport scheme?
Well, we have to consider on a three-weekly basis whether it remains proportionate, and that's an issue that we retain under active review. We'll do that again before the 16th of November. The point I'd make is that obviously, you know, we're not dealing with a fixed situation here. We're dealing with the fact that caseload is changing frequently. We're seeing, as I said in one of my earlier answers, the numbers yesterday were unsettling, very unsettling to ministers. Now, I've not seen the numbers for today. It's a bit early for that. But we'll be watching to see closely. But, you know, for example, in the briefing the Chief Medical Officer gave to Cabinet on Tuesday, the last 7 days compared to the previous 7 days, you know, we've basically been at a high, stable level for a few weeks. But in the last 7 days compared to the previous 7 days, the numbers were beginning to tick up again. So that obviously is something we'll be mindful of as to whether or not we have the right measures in place. And obviously, we have the COP summit taking place. There's a lot of people there. There's a lot of people have come into the country for the COP summit. So the possibility, which we flagged up to Parliament already, of a rise in infection over the course of the autumn, winter, whatever we're in just now, potentially puts further strain on the system. So we have to be mindful of the fact that we are dealing with a moving picture on that data.
Okay.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks very much, convener. Probably to build on some of the points that have already been raised. So on the question of when the vaccine, we would stop having the vaccine certificate, because it's part of a package, it's not specific, in a sense it's not specific because we can't tell the impact it's having. So I take it will continue along with masks and the other restrictions. it's linked to the overall number of cases, the number of people in hospital. I mean, is that kind of what you're saying?
Essentially, that's the assessment framework we've got to undertake. We have a prevalence of the virus, which is roughly, I would say, measured by the number of cases, the levels of vaccination, and the pressure on the National Health Service. Those three factors are pretty critical to the judgment. Well, they are critical to the judgment we're making. Then on the other side is a set of baseline measures which include face coverings or COVID certification or the encouragement of working from home where that's possible, which are designed to keep as much of the economy and society functioning in a fashion that's consistent with alleviating the harms of the virus. And ministers are making a judgment every 3 weeks. Do we think this is appropriately in balance? But obviously, if the case numbers in hospital get worse, then we have to look at whether the baseline measures are accurate. So in the interest of absolute candour with the committee, there is the possibility that baseline measures could be relaxed. There is also the possibility that baseline measures could be expanded. And COVID certification could potentially be extended to other sectors, or it could have no role to play within our measures. But that will be dependent on our judgment of proportionality, which is the legal duty we have to fulfil.
OK, and that's kind of where I was going next, because, I mean, I would understand in Wales there's more venues, cinemas and so on, where it will be required to have a certificate. And, I mean, I've been enthusiastic, I have to say, about the whole scheme and the fact that it is limited to what I would call extra activities or things that are not a major part of people's lives. I think that has been a good way of dealing with it. However, you know, call it creep or call it whatever, but it clearly is beginning to expand. And I think Professor Leach said there are other places requiring it. For example, I'm going to a COP meeting on Monday night and they want to see my certificate. So that's slightly more important to me. I don't go to big football matches, as members know. So I've not really been required to have it very much. So, I mean, are you worried that other organisations, you know, could be using the certificate kind of excessively? Or, you know, how do you see this moving forward?
I can quite understand in a society where many, many organisations want to play their part in suppressing the virus. And there's lots of organisations in the country, and we're very fortunate in this respect. Many organisations, many, many organisations, businesses, institutions, recognise the serious threat that's posed to human health from the virus. So they want to play their part. Now, I can understand why some of them may take a judgment that they want to, without the government requiring them to do so, to require individuals who want to come to particular events to do so. I think those organisations need to make a judgment about whether or not that is leading to any form of exclusivity as a consequence, if they're interested in wider participation. And as I'm sure the event that Mr Mason is attending, they will be interested in the range and the diversity of voices that they hear at that event. So organisations have to make that judgment. But I can understand why they want to play their part in trying to do all that we can do to suppress the spread of the virus.
What about if employers want it from employees? Does that take it to another level of kind of pressure?
Well, there will be circumstances where employers wish to exercise as much influence as they can to stop the spread of the virus, to enable them to sustain their activities. And employers have to make that judgment.
OK. Did Professor Leach want to say something on that? Or?
Let me not give my personal view. I was tempted. I would just say that globally that is becoming an issue. You'll have noticed in the US that a number of states have said public employees have to be vaccinated. I think the government, on advice and on policy decision-making, have consistently said that this will not be an obstruction to public services. I think from a clinical perspective, that's correct. In the health service, I would not want anybody to have their access to mental health care, pharmacy or anything else limited by their health status, let's say, or their ability to evidence that health status. Broader than that, I think, is a matter for civic society, and I would have a view, as would you, and the government and the parliament should decide what to do with that. There is a slightly difficult area, and that's care homes and health service employees. And the UK generally and the four health ministers continue to discuss that. There is no plan to do so, but there is an argument, I think, a clinical argument, that says care home workers are different from workers in supermarkets or in DWP. We haven't gone down that route UK-wide, and nobody is suggesting we should, but that is an area that I think will require consideration.
OK, that's helpful. Thank you. To move on to a slightly different angle, I mean, Brian Whittle was asking about ethnic minority groups and things with lower uptake. One of the figures that struck me was the kind of geographical spread of uptake, and we were shown figures, I think this was came from Spice, that, for example, on having had two doses, East Dunbartonshire is 96.4%, whereas Glasgow, where I happen to represent, is only at 78.9%, which seems quite a variation. Is that something I should be worried about?
It is something that we should all be worried about, because it clearly the levels of vaccine participation in the likes of East Dunbartonshire is, frankly getting to maximum participation, and we'd like to have all localities at that level. And we know that one of the challenges is around about areas of deprivation where people are more reluctant to come forward for such interventions. And we are trying our best through the deployment of the vaccine in the way that we have tried to do so to reach as many people as possible. And the continued communication from government is about inviting and encouraging people to be double vaccinated, and absolutely anybody that isn't yet vaccinated is very welcome to come forward through the different approaches that we have to make sure they can be vaccinated, and we would encourage that higher level of participation.
And my final point then would be, our advisers were kind of suggesting this, why are people not? Maybe we need to do more work on why people are not being vaccinated. And I mean, the three words they used were complacency, confidence and convenience as the things that are stopping people, or that we can encourage. In other words, some people are complacent about it. Probably the certificates help for that. But the confidence thing, I mean, are we just having to accept that there's a core bit of the population who will just not be vaccinated no matter what we do? Or are we needing to do more work in that area?
Well, I think if we look at those three factors, confidence, convenience and complacency, I think that the government, I think, can do something about complacency and convenience. Convenience, definitely, because we should be making the vaccines as available as readily as we possibly can do. So, for example, if somebody, the communities that Mr. Mason represents, if for example, an individual was required to use public transport to another part of the city or outside the city to get their vaccine, which involved cost, I think I can understand why that's inconvenient for people who are on low incomes. So we've got to make sure it's available as much as we possibly can do in communities. And I think Mr. Mason raises a fair point that there is we need to perhaps look afresh at the geographical distribution, and are there particular areas that we need to put buses into, put established clinics in, relevant public facilities, church halls, whatever it happens to be, to try to reach those individuals. So convenience, the government, public authorities should be doing, can do something about. Complacency, I think the public messaging from the government and the steps that we are taking are designed to tackle any issues of complacency within the population. Confidence, I think, is the sticky one, the really difficult one, because if you are somebody who is anxious about different things in life, if you're somebody who struggles with confidence in public authorities or confidence in your own well-being, that might be quite a difficult challenge for us to overcome. But what it, the way to do so, I think, is by genuine engagement with individuals and communities to try to make it as practical and possible for people to be vaccinated.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Alex Raleigh.
In terms of the way that this legislation has been brought forward, I think there are genuine concerns being expressed about the lack of scrutiny and the lack of evidence to support the objectives. And we see today that, you know, you can't make a claim that increases amongst young people is simply down to this. There is also a danger that if we start to see the vaccine passport being used and brought in by different organisations, companies, some employees being mandated that they have to use it, there is a danger that this enforcement becomes the only tool in the box. And that would be my main point today, is that, you know, I'm not convinced that the government is on top of the other measures that were brought in place, that for the majority of people who don't go to the venues that the passports used are still put at risk. So I've raised before retail, and I continue to talk shop workers who tell me, and I've seen with my own eyes going into shops, particularly younger generations not wearing face coverings. So as Brian Whittle talked earlier about the best use of resources, what resources are we actually putting in to ensure that the other measures are effective? We saw a senior member of the UK government's advisory board resign the other day, and one of the key points he was making was that face coverings were not mandatory in England, and they should be. They are mandatory here, but if people are just simply ignoring that. So is it the case the passport is easy to enforce? It's easy to enforce because you have nightclubs and other venues who will have to enforce it, or they will pay the consequences of that. But we seem to have lots of companies in retail elsewhere who are simply ignoring. Staff are being told they cannot approach people and tell people that they need to wear the face coverings. And the more you see people not doing that, and finally on that point, vaccine hesitancy, are you doing enough to counter the anti-vaxxers and the messages that's going out there? Because you will have people that see this as a big conspiracy and all the rest of it. You'll never sort that. But as social media spreads the misinformation that they're putting out, more and more people, I'm amazed by the numbers of people that are now quoting stuff at me that sounds very plausible, and that's grown. So there is a danger that you're taking your eye off the ball on the uptake of vaccine and trying to counteract the anti-vax messages that are out there. And I've seen it firsthand. There's a massive danger. You're taking your eye off the ball when it comes to the other measures that I would argue are far more important to try and counter the very real threat of the vaccine itself.
The first point, Convener, is that I'd want to assure Mr. Rowley that we do not view vaccine certification as the only tool in the box. Far from it. I think the point that Mr. Rowley makes about Sir Jeremy Farrar and his resignation from Sage over the issues of the lack of the application of face coverings in England is, I think, a fair point to make. It's a fair contrast, because we are continuing to reinforce the importance of baseline measures. I accept that there's a certain amount of resistance to those baseline measures. But the opinion polling, the government polls on these questions, generally there is a very high level of awareness of baseline measures. There is a very high level of compliance with those measures. I'm not going to say it's total, because I can see with my own eyes it's not total. There are circumstances which are of concern. Now, one of the key points that we took an update on at Cabinet on Tuesday was from members of the Cabinet who were deputed the previous week to reinforce the messaging to critical sectors in the economy about the application of baseline measures. And this has been a consistent part of the strategy the government has taken of direct engagement by ministers and our officials with sectors of the economy to make sure they are playing their part. So as a personal anecdote, I happened to be travelling on a Caledonian McBrain ferry during October. I was very struck by the public messaging that was being put in. You know, normally, when you're on a CalMac ferry, you get a safety briefing over the tannoy system. You also get briefings about the availability of high quality catering in the cafeteria as well, which is always a treat. But there was very, very heavy messaging about the importance of wearing face coverings in enclosed spaces. And I would say compliance was very, very high on that trip. Now, I appreciate that's just one example. I think I've been quite struck during COP in looking at some of the feedback from individuals who've come into Scotland talking about the level of compliance about the wearing of face coverings on public transport being much higher in Scotland than they're experiencing in other parts of the United Kingdom. So the point Mr. Rowley makes is absolutely right. These baseline measures, you know, face coverings, social distancing, hand washing, working from home, all of these baseline measures are critical. And I would contend that the government is concentrating on those measures. And yes, there's COVID, there's vaccine certification as well, but it's not the only tool in the box that we're utilising. And we'll continue to do that. On vaccine hesitancy, I think there are difficulties. You know, people are having their heads turned by some of the nonsense that's circulating. And I think the best antidote we can have to that is by putting forward sound clinical advice, which is why we invest so much time in making sure the Chief Medical Officer, the National Clinical Director and their colleagues are able to have the opportunity to interact directly with members of the public and give that clinical advice through the mainstream media and on social media in a way that I think carries a lot of weight, because these are experienced clinicians able to support the public in making their judgments and to try to counter some of the points that are circulating more widely, which would encourage vaccine hesitancy and virus scepticism. And like Mr. Rowley, I have been concerned by people and some of the things they've said to me and my constituents about these questions. It's deeply unsettling when you hear it because I know and appreciate the risks that are faced by members of the public if they're not vaccinated.
Okay. All I would say to you is that, you know, if a nightclub owner doesn't enforce a passport, then they would be in difficulty. You need to take the same approach to retailers, and if you're not prepared to take that approach, then we're going to see, particularly as I have seen firsthand, particularly amongst younger generations, just ignoring the fact that they should be wearing face coverings in shops.
I think Mr. Rowley makes an absolutely fair point. I've not in any way tried to dismiss that point. Indeed, going back to what I said in response to Mr. Whittle and Mr. Mason, if we find ourselves in the next few weeks with a rising prevalence of the virus and greater pressure on the National Health Service than we are already experiencing. The National Health Service is under absolutely colossal pressure just now, as Mr. Rowley and I have exchanged about in the chamber already. We might have to take stronger measures, which might apply greater mandatory force. Now, what we're saying to business organisations, transport providers, various public authorities, all sorts of organisations, you need to get folk to wear face coverings, to observe social distancing. You need to do the baseline stuff, because if you don't, we'll end up with more significant restrictions. And I wouldn't want the committee to take any message from me other than the fact that the government is wrestling with that dilemma. We want to avoid having to take more restrictions, but if we have to, we will, because we've got a public duty to protect members of the public.
You need to look at retail, but I have two other points. My first one I want to talk about is the redirection from accident and emergency that has been announced as a policy by the government. And I want to quote for Dr. Andrew Bust, the BMA's Scottish GP chair. So he says, this is about proper resourcing across the whole system. A&E is under massive pressure, so are GPs, and this should not result in anyone being redirected from A&E to their GP practice. Last week we discussed with Professor Leach amongst others, the very real difficulties that people are having in trying to get face-to-face appointments. Is this going to pour more pressure on other parts? Are you looking at the whole of the NHS? So simply trying to refer people and keep them out of the accident emergency, if they can't then be signposted to where they need to go, then what's the point?
I'll bring Professor Leach in a second, but I think the key point here is that people should access the healthcare resources that are appropriate for their condition. Now, I know that that's we've had a bit of a debate in the parliamentary chamber, which is a slightly less cerebral forum than the parliamentary committees where we can discuss these questions. But that's not me arguing for self-diagnosis. It's for me arguing for people only going to accident and emergency when they've had an accident and they're in an emergency situation. And I think that's an important point to establish, that people should go to the appropriate healthcare setting for the symptoms and circumstances that they have. Now, I think the point that Dr. Buist makes is that the whole healthcare system is under pressure, and I accept that unreservedly. It was not just the whole healthcare system, the whole health and social care system is under colossal pressure, because as Mr. Rowley and I have again exchanged in the chamber, part of the problem at A&E is because hospital wards are congested, and hospital wards are congested because there are people in hospital wards that shouldn't be there. They should be supported by care packages at home or in another care setting. But we don't have enough people in social care to deliver all of these settings, so there's a whole system pressure. From that, I think the best thing we can do is to try to make sure that people are supported and get their healthcare addressed in the appropriate setting to their circumstances. If somebody is having an acute emergency and needs an ambulance, that is what they should get. If they need to be admitted to A&E, they need to be admitted to A&E on clinical grounds. But if there is an alternative solution through a pharmacy or a GP or NHS Inform or whatever the device, then we should, as long as that's appropriate to the person's circumstances, we should enable them to take that up. But if you want to,
So this is not about overloading any particular piece of the puzzle. It's a whole system approach to try and get people the right care in the right place so they don't wait too long in the ED and then they don't get the right care. Come to ED with toothache, you're not going to get the right care in the ED. You're going to get that at your dentist. So if you've come there, we're going to redirect you to the right place for it. If you need an optometry review rather than a long wait and an ophthalmology review, it might be more appropriate for you to be directed to your optician rather than wait in the ED at 2 in the morning and get an ophthalmology appointment 2 days later. Mr. Buist is absolutely right. We don't want to use this as a dumping in any direction, but Andrew Buist also wants to see the appropriate patients in primary care. He doesn't want the ED patients there, and he wants primary care patients in general practice. This is one element of how we do that. It's just formalising guidance that has existed for a long time. Some EDs are better at it than others. Tayside is the best example we have. They've done redirection for many years. They've usually been at the top of the league table for weights, in terms of the top of the league table being the best place to be rather than the worst place to be. Glasgow has started to do this redirection. It's worked really well. So this is yesterday about formalising that guidance so all A&Es do the same thing.
Absolutely, say to you, we have been in this committee warning for weeks and weeks now that if primary care and community care is failing, then those people would end up at the door of the accident emergency, and that's what we're seeing happening. So if you're then sending them back into another part of the health service that's failing, then that's not going to work. But I'd like to come to my third point.
I'm not sure you can do that without asking me a question and allowing me to respond, can you?
Yeah. Well, on you go.
To me, that's the point that I acknowledge. The whole system's under pressure. I'm not sitting here trying to deny that. And, ultimately, it comes back to the fact that in a variety of different settings, and the government is trying to do as much as we can about this, we don't have enough people available to deliver the healthcare that we require. And I don't want to. I'm going to come back to talking about the availability of people because of free movement of the population. We've lost that. We've lost people who've left our country who were offering social care services, and they've gone because of Brexit and the loss of free movement. So the workforce has been thinned down because of that. It's a hard reality. Now, we're trying to recruit more people. That's why the Health Secretary has announced enhancements to social care remuneration. It's why we've expanded the resources available for social care services, because we accept entirely the point that Mr. Rowley's making, that if somebody can't be supported in their home, then they're going to end up in some form of healthcare setting. And it might not be necessary for them to be there because they could be perfectly well supported at home. But if they haven't got a care package at home, they can't be properly supported at home. And so I think we're in violent agreement here.
In terms of coming to my last point, what kind of pressure has been put on the NHS as a result of the growth of private healthcare in Scotland? Because I read just recently that demand has rocketed between April and June this year by over 1,100. There was 3,400 patients up for 2,300 over the same period last year. So if you take cardiac surgery, up 85% in private private hospitals, replacement for HAPS rose by 144%. So we seem to be moving in this country where the private sector is investing more and more, and we're seeing more growth. That must be putting pressure on NHS staffing, for example. Are you content that we're starting to see a situation grow where if you've got the money and you need a hip replacement or you need some other kind of medical treatment, the only way you're going to get that anytime soon is to go private and buy it? And therefore, those who cannot afford it goes against the very principles upon which the NHS was established.
I think I'd want to look at... I'm not familiar with the data that Mr. Rowley raises, but I think he is... You know, quite clearly, and I see this from my constituency cases, people are having to wait longer for what we now consider in life to be relatively routine procedures, hip replacements, knee replacements, cataract operations. That's why the government is investing in the elective care centres. I saw one being built actually in Inverness on Monday on the Inverness campus site. There's a 24-bedded unit being built there, which is going to be essentially one of these facilities, which is Mr. Fairley and I welcome very much the investments being made by the health service and his constituency at Perth Royal Infirmary on a similar venture. So that's the government investing to make it easier unless for what one would call routine surgery to take place, which can't be disrupted by the other disruptions that can happen within the health service. So that's all about making sure that we've got expanded capacity to deal with the fact that with an ageing population, there are going to be more people are going to need cataract, knee and hip operations. Obviously, by that investment, we are trying to make sure that happens within the National Health Service and it's available to all citizens regardless of their financial circumstances. But obviously, the private sector, if people want to pay for such treatment and they feel they have to, then that choice is available to people if they have those resources. But I also accept that potentially can draw people away from working in the National Health Service.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm just conscious of time because we've got 10 minutes left. Jim Fairley.
Best of luck with that then, lads. Unfortunately, being the sixth person to ask, there's a lot of my stuff has already been brought through, but there's some details that are missing for me, so you'll get a wee stream of consciousness here. But the first thing I want to ask is, it's twice been mentioned this morning that the Welsh system gives you a passport or a test. Am I not right in thinking it's both? you still need the passport to get into venues in Wales, and they're increasing the number of places in Wales. Is it not both as opposed to one or the other?
I don't think it's both. I think it's one or the other, but it is to a broader range of venues than ours. So ours is quite a limited range of venues, but Wales, I think from my recollection, theatres and cinemas are involved, and I think some hospitality as well.
Yep.
And hospitality, so that's, you're into much wider sectors, but I think it's one or the other.
Earlier on, there was the mention, I can't remember who mentioned it, about the hardcore that you're never going to reach. And there's always going to be a hardcore that we're never going to reach. And to be perfectly honest, I think that's, you just have to accept that that's the case. But we've got the figures here for the demographic areas where we are. And as we get to the point where we are getting to the stage where we know that that hardcore are just not going to take a vaccine, and we have to accept that that's the case, at what point is there a tipping point where you say, right, we've got everybody who's going to take the vaccine, we're controlling the virus to the best measure that we have, and I get that we can't make that straight line between, you know, well, that's worked because of that. I get it's a suite of measures, there's a kind of a belt and braces approach to it. But at what point do you get to a tipping point? You say, well, everybody that's going to take the vaccine's got it, the infection is at a stabilised rate, there is no real value in having the passport anymore because we've reached that tipping point. Is that a viable proposition to get to a later stage?
Can I come to Mr. Fairley's question in a second? But I think I better just correct what I said a second ago about Wales. Wales has introduced a mandatory NHS COVID pass on the 11th of October, and the government is planning to extend the scheme to theatres, cinemas and concert halls from the 15th of November. And on the 29th of October, the First Minister of Wales said that the hospitality industry needs to use the next 3 weeks to prepare for the possibility that COVID passes may have to be introduced in that setting. So it's not quite as definitive as I said a moment ago. So if I can just correct that point in the interests of harmony amongst devolved governments. On Mr. Fairley's point, I think there is a judgment has to be arrived at, and he's absolutely correct, and I think I covered this in my answer to Mr. Mason. There are three principal points that the government looks at in judging the state of the pandemic and the actions that were taken in relation to the strategic intent. Cases of the virus, levels of vaccination, and pressures on the National Health Service. So if we found vaccination levels getting to exceptionally high levels, cases really falling, and the health service being under less pressure, then we would not have a proportionate argument for maintaining the limited restrictions that we have in place or the vaccine certification scheme. Because we have to assess, do we think there is a proportionate argument that can be sustained for these provisions? So, in theory, that point could be reached. Well, nowhere near it, because cases are very high, very, very high. The health service is under acute pressure, and vaccine levels are really good, but they're not complete.
Okay. I'm going to come back to something that we talked about last week to Professor Leach. I was contacted by a constituent after our exchange last week regarding natural immunity as opposed to vaccination immunity. And I have to say, I have been sent reams of evidence, and I don't know if this evidence is correct or not, that natural immunity is actually more effective than vaccine immunity, because if you have natural immunity, you are being exposed to the virus's entire sequence of about 30,000 genes, as opposed to a vaccine, which is primarily only focused on the spike element. Now, there are lots of people who are saying, I want to have the freedoms that everybody else has got because I've had COVID and I don't want to take the vaccine. How do you answer that concern, that there is a belief that natural immunity
is as strong as a vaccine given immunity?
Well, I've been contacted by the same constituent, and I have that same pile of documents from a number of sources. Let's keep it simple. Natural immunity doesn't last forever, nor does vaccine immunity. So whether you've had the virus or the vaccine, you need to stay immune. So let's talk about length of time rather than type of immunity. So therefore, you need the vaccine. You are not permanently protected by either. You are temporarily protected by both. But as we said last week, I can't take your blood and decide if you're a 1 out of 10 or a 4 out of 10 or a 10 out of 10. It's literally scientifically impossible. So therefore, belt and braces, the word you used, add on your vaccine immunity to your COVID immunity. And the argument would therefore be we would just let the country catch it and then we'd be fine. That way lies real trouble for both us and the world. So vaccines on top of natural immunity. To best of my knowledge, I haven't had COVID, but if I have or if I had, I would happily take the vaccine 28 days later.
OK, but that leaves the question then for the government. If that person knows that they've had COVID and they know the timescale that they've had it, because they've had a positive test, are their rights being impinged by saying, well, I don't want to get that vaccine. I know that I have got a certain amount of immunity because I've had that positive test. Why should that person not be given the freedom to say, that is my vaccine, by having had the disease?
But for I think the simple reason that Professor Leach indicates that immunity does not last forever, whether you get it because you've contracted COVID or because you've had the vaccine. And when we look at the serious health implications of COVID for individuals, as a government, we have a duty to do all that we can to protect the health of the public in these circumstances, which requires us to take the steps that we take. Now, you know, if we just said, as I think Mr. Fairley's constituent is trying to suggest, let's just let people get COVID, then, you know, have we learned nothing for the last 18 months? Have we literally learned absolutely nothing from the last 18 months? I sat on, what day were we on, Thursday? I sat on Tuesday afternoon with the families who've lost loved ones in care homes, contributing to the thinking that the government is putting into the terms of reference on the COVID inquiry. And literally, it, you know, actually, probably the best thing on vaccine hesitancy is that we should actually get people who are vaccine hesitant to sit and have a conversation with the bereaved relatives who've lost loved ones in care homes and let them listen to it. Because I'm telling you, I sit through many conversations that are very tough in my role as a minister, and that was a tough one on Tuesday, believe you me. So maybe folks should listen to that.
Yeah, well, I'd absolutely take the point on board, and as I say, I'm merely passing on the regards of my constituent. In terms of the talking about the compulsory vaccination, we spoke in this committee before about compulsory vaccination for care home workers, and there is a company in my constituency who have made that a stipulation, and I have to say I totally agree with it, because I, like yourself, are speaking to people who have lost loved ones due to COVID. However, I'm going to move on very quickly to something that's been mentioned in here before, and that is long COVID. And I think that's, while we battle with the pandemic as it is, I think long COVID has the potential, and that's just my consideration for what I'm hearing from other people, that long COVID has the potential to give us long-term damage long after we come out of the current period that we're in. And there is specifically a group called Long COVID Kids, who are the parents of children who have had COVID, and we're talking as young as 2 and 3 year old who have got severe problems. So there's not a question here, it's merely an urging the government to look seriously at what's happening with kids with COVID.
I assure Mr. Fairley the government is doing that, because it's important that every individual has their clinical needs properly addressed and supported as they wrestle with those circumstances. And For some people, COVID will be a relatively mild experience. For others, it will have long and enduring effects. And we have to make sure, in whatever circumstance, people are properly and fully supported.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Graham Simpson, can I bring you in? And I'm really sorry because we are running really short of time now. We're meant to have finished by now, so we can make it very brief.
Yeah, ma'am, I appreciate you're up against the clock, as this committee always is, Convener. I'll be as brief as I can be. To inform the committee, is aware of the decision that the Delegated Powers Committee took on these regulations. I sit on that committee. I'm not the convener, so I can't report back in that sense. But essentially, the committee took the view that the procedure used to bring in these regulations was inappropriate. The procedure being that this came into effect, and then, as you're doing today, a committee, the policy committee, has a look at it. So the Delegated Powers Committee felt that was the wrong procedure. And just as a point of information, we're now in discussions with the government on setting up a series of protocols, which I think would be useful for everyone, to determine when the made affirmative procedure should be used. If I can ask, if I have time, just to make a comment, and people can respond if they wish. Professor Leach mentioned earlier his experience of going to the rugby on Saturday, and he also mentioned football matches. Now, I didn't go to the rugby on Saturday, but I've spoken to people who did, and their experience was they were getting waved through. Somebody's described to me a steward saying, "The app's down, in you come." I've been to 3 football matches since this scheme came into effect. The checks, such as they are cursory. I flash a bit of paper at a steward. It's not looked at in any great detail. I could be showing them anything, and you wave through. But actually, I would suggest that for any club in Scotland to do anything different would cause absolute chaos. If it was to start scanning everyone, you couldn't get everyone in. So I think the way things are actually working on the ground makes the scheme, frankly, rather pointless, because people are not being checked properly, and they're getting into events. I'm comfortable with that because I don't see how else you could do it. I asked previously, Convener, about theatres when I was last here. I think there's a bit of a confused picture. Miss Sadler told me that all Scottish theatres, were exempt from this, which is the case legally, but there's a rather confused picture out there. For instance, the Usher Hall here in Edinburgh, some events are requiring you to show a vaccine passport, some are not. If you look at other theatres, which seem to be doing their own thing, the Playhouse...
Mr Simpson, but we really have to move on. Right. Could maybe just Professor Leach or Deputy First Minister?
There's a lot in there, and I think two principal points that they'll make. The first is in relation to the made affirmative procedure. The government is dealing with a pandemic which requires us to take actions in a swift fashion, but we have to be mindful of the question of proportionality in our actions. So we used the made affirmative procedure here because we were concerned about the rising cases, but we had and about the need to improve vaccination levels, but we had to be certain that was going to be proportionate. We had to give warning that we were going to move in that direction, but ultimately the final detail could only be put in place with the swiftness that the made affirmative procedure allows us to do. I would point out that Parliament considered this question on 2 occasions before the measures came into force, one in government time and one in Conservative time, and on both occasions the government's position was supported by Parliament. But we will of course engage with the Delegated Powers Committee on these questions. On the issue of use of vaccine certificates, Celtic Football Club reported that 75% of attendees at one of their games in the last week were checked. And the initial reports from the rugby match on Saturday were that around 40% of people were checked, which is much higher than would be anticipated by the scheme. Now, I understand the concerns that Mr. Simpson has, but you know we can't have it both ways. On the one hand, Mr. Simpson and his colleagues will suggest to me that the application of the scheme is being so effective it is disrupting the nighttime economy. And then we get an argument today which is saying this scheme is not being disrupted, this scheme is not being effective at all. Now, we can't have it both ways. It's either being effective and it's disrupting parts of the economy, or it's not being effective. We can't run these arguments that are totally contradictory. They're totally, yes, they are, Mr. Fraser, they're completely contradictory arguments. So, the point I'm making is that the scheme is working well. It's working well as envisaged in all of the circumstances that it was intended for, and the government believes it to be a proportionate intervention. Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and the officials for attending today. I now move on to third agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the made affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs listed under agenda item 3 before we take the motions?
Kavira, I set out at the beginning my reflections on all of the instruments, so I won't add any further comments at this stage. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I invite any... thank you, Deputy First Minister. I now invite you to move motion S6M-01399. Would members like to comment? Mr. Fraser?
Thank you. If I can comment briefly, Convener, I don't doubt the intention of the Scottish Government in seeking to bring in the COVID certification scheme. However, we still have not heard compelling evidence that it has value, despite the assertions we've heard this morning from the Cabinet Secretary. We have, however, had significant evidence.
Sorry, Mr. Fraser, this one's about the local authorities.
Oh, well, I thought you were taking them both together. My apologies.
No, I'm going to do them separately. Sorry, that was probably my fault. I should have explained that. So, can I ask if members are agreed for motion S6M-01399 to be agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We will now consider the next motion under agenda item. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M-01529.
Move formally, Kavir.
Thank you. Now can I ask for members... Sorry, Mr. Fraser, would you like to comment?
Thank you, Kavir. I'll start again. I don't question the intention of the government on bringing in the vaccine certification scheme, but we have yet to hear evidence of its positive impacts. We have significant evidence of its negative impacts. We've heard that from the Scottish Human Rights Commission. We've heard that from those concerned about civil liberties. We've heard about the negative economic impacts. If the Scottish Government were to go down the route of offering the alternative that is offered in Wales and every other European country that has brought in a certification scheme, which is also to produce a negative COVID test, I think that's something we would be more sympathetic to, but we cannot support this scheme as it stands. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M-01529 be agreed. Do members agree?
No. Yes.
No. Okay, we'll now move to a division. Can I please ask for members who agree with the motion to raise their hands? Is that okay? Can I ask members who do not agree with the motion to raise their hands? Sorry. So no members have wished to abstain. Thank you. I'll read out the results. Myself as convener was yes for the motion. Murdo Fraser was no. Jim Fairley, yes. John Mason, yes. Alex Rowley, yes. And Brian Whittle, no. So we've got 4 agreed, 2 disagreed. So the motion passes. Thank you. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. I would like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. I will now suspend to allow a changeover of witnesses. Members are advised that we will have a short comfort break during the suspension. Thank you.
Good morning. I bring this meeting back into session and we move to agenda item number four. This morning we're taking evidence from a panel of experts in ventilation on baseline health protection measures. I would like to welcome to the meeting Dr. Hewell Davis, Technical Director of Chartered Institution of Building Services Engineers, Dr. Sean Fitzgerald, Director of the Centre for Climate Repair at Cambridge University, Professor Catherine Noakes, Professor of Environmental Engineering for Buildings, University of Leeds, and Professor Tim Sharp, Head of Architecture at the University of Strathclyde. Welcome. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. This is the first of four evidence sessions we have planned on baseline health protection measures. These measures are the main tools we are using to respond to the COVID-19, and they include steps we are taking to enhance ventilation in our homes, workplaces, and settings where public services are delivered. This morning's session really is a short scoping session for us to consider the role of ventilation and what, how it will be play in lessening the impact of COVID-19, especially over the winter period. We'll also consider the role of ventilation might play in the recovery phase of the pandemic. We hope this session will inform further sessions we plan to hold as part of this inquiry, where we'll be hearing from stakeholders in health and social care services, the hospitality, business and leisure sectors, and also in schools. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Could the witnesses briefly outline what you think are the main challenges that we need to address in relation to ventilation as part of our response to COVID and for the longer term recovery? Can I start with Dr. Davies?
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity.
Dr. Davies, I think you're on mute. We were having a few technical issues earlier on.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Thank you. So good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee. In terms of where we might want to go, certainly in the short term, the biggest opportunity is around getting people to concentrate on what they've got and getting it to work properly. One of the things that's become quite clear over the last year to 18 months is that a lot of buildings haven't been as well ventilated as they could be, that things that should be working haven't been working, perhaps things haven't been properly maintained, and getting people to do those things would be a very good start and need not be hugely expensive or time consuming. There are some fairly straightforward things that can be done. And I believe the committee is aware of some of the guidance that that the institution has produced along with others, including the HSE. Another area where I think perhaps we could concentrate is just getting over some of the basic messages about the role of ventilation. And I did look before the hearing at some of what has been produced on the Scottish Government website, and there's some helpful material there. You know, the role of getting fresh air into buildings is important, and it might be worth asking Dr. Fitzgerald to talk a little bit about the use of windows, because I think that's something that perhaps it seems a very simple, trivial thing, open the window, but there might be a little bit more to it than that. So there's a lot we can do around fairly simple tasks before we get into more complicated discussions. But I think it might be worth turning to Dr. Fitzgerald to talk about the use of windows, for example.
Thank you, Dr. Davies. Can I bring in Dr. Fitzgerald? Just one comment I'd like to just make, as we live in very cold Scotland and moving into the winter, having energy prices increasing astronomically at the moment and opening our windows. That's just my hesitation. I understand why we would do it for ventilation, but in reality, are people going to do that when they can't afford their energy bills? But can I please bring in Dr. Fitzgerald?
Yes, and again, thank you for allowing us to actually contribute to this session. I'm grateful for that. So for me, there are two issues, and one is ensuring that spaces are adequately ventilated. And I think there needs to be absolute clarity that we don't want places to be so cold that actually we've lost the battle in terms of therefore making environments, especially working environments, educational environments. If they're so cold, then why, if people are coming in there and they're not able to function, learn appropriately, then they may as well be at home. So we've got to make sure that we don't have spaces that are overly cold, but conversely, we've got to make sure that they are providing appropriate amounts of ventilation. And one of the things that could help greatly is ensuring that spaces are using high-level windows rather than low-level windows wherever possible. There are two benefits for that. The first is that if the air is coming in through a high-level window, it will then mix with the interior air before it then hits anybody, and therefore you can help ameliorate what would otherwise be fairly cold drafts. So that's the first point. The second point is that if anyone is standing or anything like this, if you're just using low-level openings, frankly, that air at the top of the room is not then being ventilated and displaced. So for a health benefit as well, you want to ensure that you're using high-level windows. But unfortunately, my experience is that many, many spaces are still not that well maintained. And if you have older type buildings which are using, for example, sash windows, it is quite common for the top sashes to be painted shut and therefore people just using the lower sash windows. And it's very simple, but the idea about cracking the top sash windows open can provide massive benefits. But I would stress, back to your point, Kavina, is that it's important that we don't freeze the spaces, and therefore what we're looking for is ensuring that it's the very poorly ventilated spaces. We need to bring them up to a standard so that we then don't have major hotspots for infections. And then the second issue that I would like to cite is to do with culture. And that is, there are certain work environments and educational environments where there almost seems to be a huge focus where there is a lot of ventilation. I would argue sometimes too much ventilation if we're going to then impair the learning of children, for example. So I'm in lots of environments where there's been a lot of attention to ventilation, which is great, but I think it's important that we then don't overventilate that. And then comparing that with other environments, and the one that I'm going to cite is mainly the retail hospitality sector in particular, where there can be challenges regarding providing those spaces with ventilation. And especially as the colder weather sets in, just keeping the windows closed. So there seems to be very disparate, high degree of disparity between different kinds of settings where ventilation is adhered to. And I'm going to let somebody else speak, actually, how you might gauge what is an appropriate level of ventilation through the use of, for example, carbon dioxide monitors. But it might be best, perhaps, if Professor Noakes or Professor Sharp might comment on that.
I think Professor Noakes has asked to speak. Can I invite you in, Professor Noakes?
Yes, thank you very much. And again, thank you for inviting me to join this session today. So I was just going to make two comments. One was, I think there is, we've talked about some of the things already that you can do around ventilation, but before we even get to that point, people need to know why ventilation matters. And you know, I think there is a variability in knowledge still, that some people are still very much focused on washing their hands and that virus transmits on surfaces. And actually, as we've gone through the course of the pandemic, we've learned an awful lot more about transmission. It is very likely now that the majority of transmission happens through inhalation of the virus. You're at greater risk of that when you're close to somebody. But in certain settings, and particularly in rooms where people are maybe doing talking for long periods of time, singing for long periods of time, or doing aerobic exercise, they generate more virus particles, and then you can get this longer range airborne transmission across a room at more than 2 meters. So, but I think getting across the understanding of transmission then helps people to understand why ventilation matters. And of course, it matters much more in workplace settings, educational settings, communal settings, than in, you know, your own home. If you were in your home when it's just you and your family, it's less of an issue. You don't need to have your windows wide open all the time if you don't interact with others. but perhaps when you have visitors, you should be thinking about ventilating an environment. When it comes to ventilation, I think just to follow on from the short points that Dr. Fitzgerald made, one is the fact that we don't have to open windows, we don't have to ventilate continuously. You can actually open windows a small amount. When the weather's colder, you actually get more ventilation as the weather gets colder for the same size of opening. So you can get away with making, apologies, it's a bit noisy, if you've got some background noise there. I'm by the main road with an open window, but you get as you reduce the size of an opening in cold weather, you still get quite good flow through those openings. So you don't need anywhere near as big a window opening in cold weather as you do in warm weather, and therefore you can also open windows periodically rather than just opening them all the time. You perhaps open them for a few minutes every hour to refresh the air in a space, and that can help you manage that balance between temperature and energy bills and ventilation. And then, as Dr. Fitzgerald indicated, carbon dioxide meters in some settings might be a very good way of managing that ventilation. So a carbon dioxide meter, a human breathes out carbon dioxide. We breathe it out at a higher rate than is naturally present in the air. So when you measure carbon dioxide in an indoor environment, it gives you an idea of how much of the air in that space has previously been breathed by other people, how much of it is exhaled air and how much of it is fresh air. And the closer it is to background levels, outdoor levels are around about 400 parts per million, the better the ventilation is. We've looked at some of the data on this, and we've suggested that if buildings have carbon dioxide levels are around about 800 parts per million or less, that's actually quite good ventilation. But if you have regularly seeing high values of sort of 1500 parts per million or much higher, you really should be thinking about trying to improve the ventilation in that space or reducing the occupancy in that space. And carbon dioxide meters can be used for this. It's not something you can do in every space, but it works quite well, particularly in offices or schools, classrooms, spaces which have got the same people in regularly over periods of time. And perhaps I'll hand over to Professor Sharp, who may be able to talk a little bit more about this.
Yes, thank you. And again, thank you for the opportunity to speak. And yes, so I would agree with all the points which have been made previously. One of the challenges about ventilation is that it is at the same time very, very simple and very, very complicated. And one of the issues with it is that you can't see or feel ventilation in the same way as you can see or feel thermal comfort. So trying to assess what the ventilation is of a space is actually quite challenging. And that's one of the reasons that things like CO2 monitors can be helpful, in that they give you some kind of indication of what's going on in that space. And that can be useful in terms of, you know, if nothing else, raising an awareness of what's going on there. They are by no means a measure of ventilation. They are an indicator. There are all sorts of it's a very blunt tool, but nevertheless, it is a potentially useful tool in some situations. And gives an opportunity for users to help to manage their space. So the first port of call here really is trying to get people to do what they can to manage that ventilation. And that includes that thermal comfort issue. You don't want to overventilate and be very cold, but at the same time, you want to get reasonable levels. So having something which helps you to maintain that level is quite useful. I think the other thing, just in terms of the measures, I mean, so the first measure is, yes, just trying to get occupants and people, and indeed building owners, to do what they should be doing in terms of managing that space. The second then is, if what we're seeing is spaces which don't appear to be well ventilated or can't be well ventilated, what measures do we need to take? So that is things like, you know, unsticking those windows, making sure that the systems are effective and work, and perhaps, you know, introducing other, you know, relatively kind of simple things. I mean, there are windows, there are also vents, you know, it doesn't have to be a window. There are things like trickle vents in some spaces, which give you that background. As Professor Noakes said, it doesn't need to be leaving things open all the time. It may be intermittent opening. So, for example, in classrooms between classes, just purging that space is a useful kind of is a useful technique. What we're concerned about, so ventilation is one of a hierarchy of measures, and the concern really here is for spaces which might be more affected by ventilation. So they are spaces which are occupied for a long period of time by relatively high numbers of people. So that's the principal concern.
Thank you very much. It's some very fascinating points raised there. Just one quick question. Just looking at businesses, for example, and maybe people looking at returning people back to offices and the hospitality industry, how accessible is a carbon dioxide readings for normal businesses to get those kind of readings from their premises? I'm not sure who would like to come in.
Well, I can contribute in that I used to run a company where we provided lots and lots of these sorts of sensors as part of just our standard fare. I mean, they are typically anywhere between £100 and £200 per sensor, depending on how many you buy, and they are reasonably available. Clearly, I don't think we could provide, for example, 32,000 monitors for all the schools all in one fell swoop, but they are available. And what I would urge people is to think carefully about the quality of the sensors and the timescale of the urgency. The reason being is that the more expensive, the better the sensor, and the less work they then need in terms of what we call calibration. Some of the cheaper ones actually might therefore be only appropriate for this current winter. But in terms of just the priorities, maybe that is okay for the moment. I'll hand over to others then.
Okay, thanks very much. Oh, I might bring in members for questions. Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. I just have one question for the panel in relation to the issues in schools. So I receive quite a number of complaints from teachers who at the moment are complaining that in certainly most of the schools I'm aware of, the ventilation is purely open windows, which in the summer might be fine, but at this time of year is clearly causing an increasingly uncomfortable environment, both for the teaching staff and also for the pupils. And we have in many schools a situation where the radiators are positioned close to or even under the windows. So the heating's on full blast. Most of the heat's going straight out the window. And that's not just bad for the climate, but it's also very bad for the school's heating bills, as you might imagine. Now, the First Minister announced back in the summer she was providing local authorities with an additional £10 million to support enhanced ventilation in schools. I'm wondering if anybody's got any sense of what would be the likely overall cost in fitting adequate ventilation to schools to try and deal with this issue. And even if the money was available, how practical and under what timescale could that work actually be done? Because presumably it would take months, if not years, to bring every school in Scotland up to an adequate standard.
Can I please bring in Professor Noakes, because I do know that you wish to comment. Thank you.
Yes, so, I mean, it is a real challenge, and I think what it's demonstrating is we have got a legacy of buildings that we have not thought very much about for many, many years. I guess going back to the beginning, about a point earlier around carbon dioxide monitoring, for the short term, that can be quite a viable solution for schools to, because many of these carbon dioxide monitors, as well as showing you the CO2 levels, will also show you the temperatures. So you can try and use that to balance the environment. But I appreciate it is a very difficult thing for schools to manage. And we probably do need to start thinking about what is the strategy for how you identify those schools which do not have effective ventilation, and how you start to put a plan together for improving that ventilation over the longer term. And what you may find, I think, is that it's not all schools. There will be some schools which are, there are issues across the whole of the school estate. There are other schools where it might be a very small number of rooms which have issues. There are other things that can be done in the short term, so it's possible to use portable air cleaning technologies, which might rely on basically pulling the air in the room through a high-efficiency particulate filter, which can then remove virus from the air and enable... it doesn't ventilate the space, but it will reduce risks in those spaces, which are perhaps harder to ventilate. But ultimately, they are only a temporary solution because they do not ventilate a space. And we know that ventilation is not just important for COVID reasons, it's also important for productivity and cognitive reasons, as well as general health and well-being. Every school, every workplace will be different. There's no sort of simple one-size-fits-all retrofit solution. But there are technologies out there, for example, mechanical ventilation with heat recovery systems, which can be retrofitted. They can often be quite standalone systems. And it is, but I couldn't tell you the costs of it. It's not sort of something that I've particularly looked at. But it will cost money. But I guess this is something that as a long-term strategic challenge, thinking about the health of the public health benefits wider than COVID, thinking about exposure to air quality, thinking about learning outcomes, and thinking about preparation for what might be the next pandemic. Perhaps it's time that we thought about that long-term investment in some of our buildings. It is a legacy that we haven't necessarily invested in them over many years.
Thank you. Can I please bring in Professor Sharp?
Yes, thank you. So a couple of things just on that point. So firstly, buildings should be designed and constructed and maintained to meet building standards. That's the case, you know, whether we're in COVID or not. And one of the unfortunate facts is that this pandemic has revealed some deficiencies there, unfortunately. You know, and one of the challenges we have here is that, we realise now that we have very little knowledge about how buildings actually perform in practice, and that's a real kind of challenge that we have here. So, you know, buildings should be doing what they should be doing in terms of kind of meeting regulations. So, you know, that's sort of still non-negotiable. You know, what this gives an opportunity to do, I think, is to gather some information on how those buildings are working and then to put in those measures to try and make the performance in general, and that's a whole range of things. That's certainly ventilation, but it's also energy as well. One of the big challenges of construction is that we don't regularly go back and monitor the results of our buildings, and therefore we are flying a little bit blind here in terms of understanding actual performance and therefore the implications of that.
Thank you. Can I please bring in Professor Fitzgerald?
Yes. So back to the specific question regarding, you know, the idea about opening windows and the heat going out of the windows. I just repeat in terms of the preferred strategy. If you've got a school and all you've got right now, and I am thinking about the current winter, is opening windows, is the use of the high level windows. The problem being is that if you have a low level window and a high level window, which is often used, then the air will come in through the low-level window, heated by the radiator. And actually, what that radiator is really doing is not only adding heat to the air to ameliorate what would then be a cold draft, it's actually then causing heating in the classroom. And if you're ventilating at in accordance with modern building regulations, the classroom then gets too hot, weirdly, and then the air is then leaving through the high-level vent. All of those problems are changed if you are focusing on just using high-level vents, then the radiator itself will be a lot more effective and use a lot less energy. So as director of the Centre for Climate Repair, and a lot of my research and work has been about trying to reduce the energy consumption in the built environment, and I've done a huge amount with schools, getting the ventilation strategy right, and my first port of call will be to try and use the infrastructure which you already have, namely the opening windows, and being smart about the way that they are used. If in the future, there is an opportunity to look at, for example, putting in some assisted devices because the opening windows are just not the right design or they're insufficient, then if you want, in terms of the prices within the industry, something like £3,000 to £5,000 for equipment alone is about the order to go and fix ventilation in many kinds of classrooms.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener.
This is the COVID Recovery Committee, and I actually see this as a bit of an opportunity. Professor Sharp, you were just talking about the building regulations that we currently have. If you're building a house right now, you have to make sure that you've got the trickle ventilation in the windows compared to the size of the room for the size of the window that you have, etc., etc. So there is an opportunity here for us to be able to, because you're absolutely right, I've been in schools myself where you can't get the window open. That was the case when I was at school a very long time ago. And some of those windows won't have been open since then. So there's an opportunity here for us as a country to say, right, OK, well, we've got a problem. We know what this problem will help us to transmit a virus in these enclosed spaces. So a very simple solution to some of these high opening windows, and I'm taking on what you're saying, Dr. Fitzgerald, about the high-level ventilation. By simply putting in trickle vents to some of these wood-framed windows in some of these older Victorian schools, is that going to be sufficient to be able to allow us to have the heat down the bottom, the trickle vent at the top? Is that in itself going to be enough to create enough ventilation within some of these spaces?
Would you like me to answer that?
Yes, please.
Right. So look, my experience is as follows. Trickle vents are typically very small, and the amount of ventilation that you get there is probably insufficient for 30 children. What I am going to repeat, Professor Noakes' point, that for a given opening, when it gets cold outside and you're trying to maintain an interior temperature of, say, 21 degrees centigrade, you get a lot more ventilation because of the bigger temperature difference, the bigger density difference, and of course in winter you've got more wind blowing as well. So I would just urge that we just look at our high level windows and see whether we can get those to function properly. And unfortunately, this is revealing a problem in the way that we maintain and manage our buildings and the attention that we've put over the years regarding making sure that everything is working properly. And it's just revealing some problems that, in terms of the culture within the facilities management aspect of buildings. So I think that's what we need to address, rather than saying we're going to go and fit trickle vents in windows.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I was going to bring in John Mason because he's got to leave to go to the chamber shortly.
Thanks very much. I mean, building on what folk have said so far, I think I've got a couple of questions. So my first one would be, I'm kind of assuming that older buildings might be better than newer buildings because the ceilings are higher, they're probably more drafty because they're not so sealed. I mean, I'm thinking both of public buildings and of people's homes. I mean, is that a fair assumption? Professor Noakes, I think you were kind of nodding a little bit.
I think this will depend. So if in a lot of places, yes, the older buildings will have the higher ceilings. They will be leakier and they will naturally have more ventilation. It's very uncontrolled ventilation often in a leaky building. One of the challenges we've had is, though, that some buildings have been retrofitted over the years, and quite often those very old buildings have been retrofitted with UPVC windows, and instead of now having windows which open at both the low level and the high level, they now only open at one place. They're cheaper windows. We've engineered out often the ventilation strategies that were put in place in those original buildings. And again, it's thinking through the consequences of something that might have been done for an energy perspective and may have been done for cost reasons. You know, it is cheaper to have a window that only has one opening than has two openings or has three openings. And I think this perhaps comes back to the earlier point around trickle vents, that rather than just saying, should we retrofit a few trickle vents, if we are going to put some effort in to improving schools, there's one thing doing some very cheap, quick actions that may solve an immediate or may reduce an immediate problem. But if we're going to put effort in, we should make sure we do it properly and don't sort of retrofit some trickle vents which are not quite there. And say, OK, we've solved that, and then come back to this problem in 5 years' time and go, oh, I wish we'd done that differently. So I think it's worth thinking through, you know, what is there, what was originally designed for the ventilation strategy in that space? Is that ventilation strategy still applicable, or has it changed over the years? And then what can we do to improve that? And I mean, I think there is probably a set of buildings which are quite likely those built in the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, which are probably the ones we'll struggle with the most, where energy was a big focus, there was a reduction in the size of the spaces, it's much harder to get good ventilation in those, and they may be the buildings which are the hardest to deal with. And perhaps it's worth bringing in Dr. Fitzgerald on this.
Could I just bring in Professor Sharp, because he asked to come in. Thank you.
I'll try and make these brief points. So one of which is, so the regulations apply to new buildings, and in fact the vast majority of the stock is older buildings, which would have been built to older regulations or indeed no regulations at the time. And then, as points have been made, will have been kind of changed and so on. And so there are lots of examples of that. I think the point I'd like to make is that when we are doing these measures, they need to be designed. They need to be not just kind of put in as blanket measures. They need to be undertaken in consideration with the whole performance of the building. So that includes the energy performance as well. So, you know, there are plenty of examples where we've done things as single measures, and you know, examples include things like, forms of retrofit for thermal performance, which hasn't included then measures for ventilation. So you get these unintended consequences. So I think it's very important that when we are thinking about these measures, we are trying to design them. We're trying to understand what their actual performance is intended to be.
Thank you. Can I bring in Professor Fitzgerald, followed by Professor Davies? I think you're on mute.
Am I unmuted now?
You're unmuted. Thank you.
So look, back to Professor Noakes' comment. You know, the buildings which are more modern, what we've found is that it's cheaper to build buildings with a shallower floor to ceiling height. There's just less wall, and therefore the buildings are cheaper. And unfortunately, those buildings are therefore not as well suited to the old strategy in Victorian type of buildings, where actually if they had a sash window, you could just crack the top sash open and allow the air to come in naturally and mix with enough of the warm room air to ameliorate a cool draft. So the higher the floor to ceiling height, the less the problem of cold drafts is. So Professor Noakes is completely right that when you have these more modern buildings, and it's the 60s plus buildings, which have been, they're built on the cheap, which have got shorter floor to ceiling heights, they're the ones where actually we've got more of the drafts issue, which is where actually you then have that issue where we're going to try and, you know, preheat the air with radiators, which then has energy penalties. So which is where actually maybe some assisted mixing is therefore going to be necessary, or indeed heat recovery units. So it is the more modern buildings that I think are the bigger challenge than some of the more historic ones.
Professor Davies.
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up on the regulatory aspect, because one of your members made a comment about the opportunity that there may be here. We know that we're going to have to make a significant effort to improve the energy performance of our buildings. And we're also now aware that we need to think about ventilation. And it's really important that we do take a systematic approach here and don't allow people to pick off one issue at a time. And when buildings are being worked on to improve their energy performance, it's really important that ventilation is also considered. And there's a real opportunity, particularly in Scotland, where you have a single system of building verifiers in the public sector. They do need to be encouraged to see the role that they can play when they're supervising projects to make sure that ventilation is properly considered at the design stage and then properly installed. It's easy to put it in the design and get it signed off. Sometimes designs then get altered. The euphemism is value engineering. It's neither engineering nor does it usually add value. It's usually about taking out cost, and some of that cost is associated with providing important things. So the building verifiers really do need to be encouraged to make ventilation and energy efficiency seen as two sides of the same coin, and then we avoid running the longer term risks of people thinking, well, I can either have good ventilation or I can have energy efficiency and lower bills. It doesn't need to be that way. We can ventilate well and be energy efficient if we think it through in a systematic way. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you.
Are we okay for time? Can I have another? I'll maybe aim this one just purely at Professor Noakes, because it was a follow-up to what she said to Murdoch Fraser. She used terms which I'm trying to get my head around: air cleaning technologies and high efficiency particulate filters. I mean, I had a particular issue with ScotRail, our railway operator, and that may be slightly different for buildings, but they have some trains with windows which are locked, so they could open, but they weren't. And I said to them, wouldn't it be better to open the windows? And they said that their artificial air circulation system was just as good as having the windows open. Is that likely to be true or not?
It quite likely is true. It was difficult to say exactly, because every system is different, but it is quite likely that they will have a mechanical ventilation system that can provide fresh air that is as effective as opening windows. The risks on public transport are difficult to understand. It's a very difficult environment to get direct evidence as to whether transmission actually happens on public transport. If we think about the factors that influence risk, it is proximity to people, which of course public transport does increase that risk. It's activity, so public transport perhaps decreases that risk, because a lot of the time people are relatively passive on public transport. It's wearing of face coverings, which of course if wearing of face coverings is done well, then that reduces risks on public transport quite significantly, because you are reducing the amount of virus put into the environment. And then it's also duration of time. So when we're thinking about public transport journeys, very short journeys, commuter type journeys, which are often only maybe 20 minutes or so, are probably relatively low risk, but it's the from an airborne transmission perspective, but it's the longer duration journeys where people might be in the same carriage as others for several hours, where we really need to be thinking about ventilation. Particularly trains, there are some trains which are designed to have their windows opened and can have their windows open. They tend to be the shorter distance commuter journeys. And I would probably urge that they should have their windows open as far as it's practically possible. There are certain weather conditions where it's probably not going to work, because you're going to end up very wet. But certainly those longer distance journeys, they rarely have opening windows, because of the speeds that those trains go and the pressures that you get through them. They're not practically designed to have opening windows, and they're designed in such a way to have a ventilation system that usually has an air change rate in the carriage around about 8 air changes per hour. So that's a fresh air rate every 7 to 10 minutes or so in that space.
That's great. That's very helpful. Thanks so much.
Thank you. I'll move on to Alex Rowley for a question. Then could we please go to Professor Fitzgerald?
Okay, Camino. Just a quick question. So returning to schools and to the short term, the here and now, as we head into winter, so the Scottish Government has continued the policy that face coverings should be used in schools. But what would your immediate advice be to education authorities? I mean, education authorities will have property managers that manage the school estate, but is there the skills and the knowledge, or do we need to try and bring in skills and knowledge to advise? And Murdo Fraser mentioned earlier £10 million, which is not a lot if you're going to try and... So what in the short term, immediate term, would you advise government and advise education authorities to be doing as we approach winter?
So, I mean, I'll just chip in briefly. My urgent request would be that it's simple. It's about making sure many of the schools will have just opening windows, and are they properly maintained? Do we have the high level windows? And this is not a skills issue. This is a has a previous budget issue and attention to this and adherence. So that would be my priority. I'm going to let somebody else comment on the use of face coverings and things. But from an estate's point of view, I would immediately be looking at the high level windows. And then back to the other issue regarding making sure we then don't freeze the spaces. This is where carbon dioxide monitors can help try and make sure that actually we're providing enough ventilation, but not so much ventilation that then we've got energy bills issues and thermal comfort issues.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. Davies?
Thank you. I'm going to be very quick. I think it's largely about making sure that what is there, as Dr. Fitzgerald has said, is working. Older schools, lots of instances of windows being painted so that they can't open. It's really the basic audit, is what we've got working? If schools have got CO2 monitors, they can be useful in identifying areas where there may be a greater risk, and then focus on those places where there may be a greater risk of transmission. Is that because something isn't working? Is it because that space just has never been very well ventilated and we haven't had a reason to find out until now? And in those circumstances, Professor Noakes' comment about air cleaners may well be one way of dealing with that. It may just be that it reveals one or two spaces that are currently so badly ventilated that they'd be better not used for a few weeks, and some advice taken on how to deal with that. But those would be immediate short-term things to reduce risk over the next few weeks and months.
Thank you. I'll bring in Brian Whittle, and could I then bring in Professor Noakes, who wishes to come in? Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. I think I'll be very brief. I think a lot of points have been covered. I think everybody recognises the importance of ventilation, not just in for COVID, but for many other considerations, and also the fact that CO2 monitoring would be beneficial. I think I want to really look at the practicalities of developing a country with buildings with good ventilation. I think, as we know, and I think it was indicated by the convener right at the start, poverty is a major driver of the virus proliferation. So the practicalities of developing all of our buildings into good ventilation, I think, is beyond the budget even of the government. So presumably what we're talking about here is a focus very much on commercial properties rather than domestic.
Okay, yes, so I was going to make two points, one prior to that and one related to that question. So I think the first one is, there was a previous comment about face coverings as well as ventilation. And I think it's really important that we recognise that ventilation is only one of the mitigation measures for this virus, and that we also have to think about other mitigations in spaces too. So that may include measures to think about how we mitigate at short proximity to people. The ventilation will not mitigate close range transmission, and that's where face coverings and distancing enter things. And we also have to think about using other strategies, such as requiring people to stay at home when they've got symptoms, making sure we've got good testing in place, etc., to limit the chance of having infected people in the space. Looking at that long-term question, though, how do we get our buildings to be good? It is a really big challenge, and actually I think we need to recognise that this is a long-term goal. It's not going to be something that gets solved overnight. But if we don't have an ambition for that long-term goal, then it will never happen. And I think it's really important that ambition gets tied up with net zero. There is a long-term ambition to reduce emissions and make our environments more energy efficient, reduce the impact on the climate. I think we need to tie ventilation in with that. So as we're putting in measures to, say, put heat pumps into buildings, to insulate buildings, actually making sure they're ventilated at the same time should be part of that long-term strategy. And that applies to commercial buildings and domestic buildings. With regard to commercial buildings, though, I do think that we're going to have a hierarchy. We need to start with the worst ones. So if we look again at schools, as I know that example's come up several times, there will be schools that have already got good ventilation in the majority of their classrooms. They're perhaps not such a concern. There'll be others which have okay ventilation, but occasionally it's not great. We could look at what we can do to those in the short term and think about sort of some longer term improvements there. But the ones which we'd have the most concerned about are the ones which really have truly inadequate ventilation, which are impacting on much more widely on people's health and well-being. And those are the ones where we should be saying, actually, we need to think through a programme. We need to perhaps first, the first question is that building fit for purpose? And, you know, I know there are programmes to build new schools, build new buildings. Those perhaps are the ones we should be looking at in terms of priorities for those types of programmes. But where we do think the building is fit for purpose, we can then say, well, what's the, you know, those should be the priority spaces where we have to invest. But it is a long-term strategy, but it needs to be, there needs to be that ambition to make that work. We can have that ambition with other things. I don't know why we can't have the same ambition to make sure we have healthy buildings. And the benefits could be enormous.
Thank you. Can I please bring in Professor Sharp?
Thank you. Yes. These aren't okay. A couple of things. We know how to do this. This is not rocket science. You know, we know what the tools and technologies are to make buildings perform very well. It's just that we don't do it as a matter of course, and that's the challenge here. So, you know, there are plenty of ways of addressing this problem. You know, and it is this problem of thinking about the building as a whole system. And making sure that it's properly designed, constructed, and then maintained to maintain that system. You know, this isn't an impossible challenge by any stretch of the imagination. In a sense, the problem really is a lack of political will to a certain degree. There is certainly something about whether our regulations are being properly complied with and checked and so on. And then there are some important questions about what we do about retrofit. You know, building regulations don't apply to retrofit unless, you know, it's taking, you know, you're making some significant things. So I think that's, again, an area that we should perhaps look at. So a lot of these things, I think, there are some technical challenges, but there are also significantly kind of policy challenges in terms of do we want to really mandate these things?
Thank you very much. Can I ask if any other members have any further questions? Thank you very much. I thank the witnesses for all their evidence and for giving us their time this morning. It's been very beneficial. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with them on how to do that. The committee's next meeting is on the 11th of November, when we will continue to take evidence on baseline health protection measures. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend this meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you.